I apologize for not having slides this morning for our lesson. Sometimes just unable to get some things done in the amount of time that I have. And so if you'll bear with me without the slides this morning, I appreciate it. We're actually in part two of a series we began last week, but I think each of these lessons are able to stand on their own. But we're talking about religious division. If you recall, last week we looked at going back to the Tower of Babel and the power of unity that was discussed in that particular text of Genesis chapter 11. There in verse 6, where God pointed out that they had one language and that whatever they determined to do, whatever they had in purpose, that they would be able to accomplish it, that nothing would be impossible for them because of their unity. And that shows us, I think, the great power of unity when we are speaking the same thing of the same mind. And so the problem in Genesis 11 with the Tower of Babel is the fact that they may have been united, but it wasn't in the will of God. Yes, we see what God says about the power of unity, but He wants us not only to be united together as one people, but united with Him in His will, in His purpose. We then went through and showed how the children of Israel, and even after the division of the kingdoms, the northern kingdom of Israel, the southern kingdom of Judah, and then later coming back from captivity, how the Jews were divided into various sects, such as the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Essenes, and the Zealots. Some would even say that perhaps the Herodians and Hellenists, but at least the four different groups. And I propose that Jesus was a part of none of them. He had no part in the religious division that was taking place. He was a Hebrew, quite simply put. He wasn't for the division, but rather He came in that respect to bring them together once again through one united will, which was the will of God. That was His purpose. And I pointed out that the difference between the division amongst the Jews and denominationalism today was the fact that the division amongst the Jews, they were all still Jews. Now that may seem a little bit harsh if you get what I'm saying, and the fact that denominationalism is not a part of the body of Christ. And we'll get into that a little bit more in our lesson today. But we kind of wrapped up and looked at Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34, which is quoted in the book of Hebrews chapter 8. Which talks about the change that would be coming, how it was that you would be born into Judaism. You would be born as a Hebrew. But a time was coming where no longer would you be born into this religious group, the Hebrews, and then be taught, but rather you would be taught and voluntarily come into being a child of God, into the body of Christ, by your choice, not by the choice of others. And Jesus, in fact, was making this point to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, verses 3 through 5. When Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee on the seat of the Sanhedrin council, came to Jesus by night, and Jesus kind of preempts the discussion and the questions that Nicodemus has and says, listen, if you want to see the kingdom of God, you need to be born again. In other words, to be born as a Hebrew, oh sure, that had some significance, but the change that Jeremiah spoke of was coming. And it was here. It was now. You will have to be born again to enter the kingdom of God. And with that, many false teachers arose. They came about wanting people to understand that okay, maybe there will be a second birth, but you must first become a Jew. And there was great debate that took place in Acts chapter 15. As there were some who left Jerusalem who went to Antioch, and they were teaching that in order to become a Christian, you must be circumcised. And Paul and Barnabas and others went back to Jerusalem, and no small debate took place, and they wrote a letter back to the church in Antioch and said, "We gave them no such command. This isn't true. This isn't what is necessary." Paul equates it when he writes by inspiration of King Jesus in Colossians chapter 2 in verses 9 through 12, where really 9 through 13 of Colossians chapter 2, where he talks about circumcision. And he says there that there was a circumcision, but now the circumcision is one not made with hands. There is a spiritual circumcision that is going to take place. And he goes on in verse 12 to describe it. You will be buried in baptism. Wherein? Through faith in the power of the operation of God who raised Him from the dead, you will be raised up with Him. You will be quickened or made alive, verse 13, and that your transgressions will be forgiven. Not through a physical circumcision, that isn't necessary, that's not required, but through a spiritual circumcision, which is immersion in the watery grave of baptism. And when he wrote to the churches of Galatia in Galatians chapter 1, there beginning in verse 6, he says, "I marvel you've turned so quickly from the grace of God who has called you to another gospel, which is not another." They were teaching circumcision. They were teaching parts of the old law which had been nailed to the cross, which were no longer of effect or binding for us today. He said, "This isn't the case. And if anyone tries to teach these things, let them be accursed. If they're teaching something other than what we've delivered unto you, let them be accursed." This isn't a part of the gospel of Christ. And so what they were doing is they were pulling together what Christ had already delivered and now what they were receiving from the Holy Spirit, which was a part of the unity that Jesus spoke about going all the way back to the Gospel of John. Even when he was met by that woman at the well, the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4, and she was asking about the worship that would take place, where it would be, how it would be done. Because right now there was a division between the Jews and the Samaritans. In fact, the Jews despised the Samaritans, wouldn't allow them to enter into the temple. They weren't to be a part of any of that. And Jesus says in John 4, verse 23 and 24, that the time is coming and now is when the true worshiper will worship God in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship Him. For God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. What he is saying is there's going to be a unity that is going to take place through the Messiah, through Christ Himself. That no longer would there be a division between Jew and Samaritan, or Jew and Gentile for that matter. But that it would all be according to truth and we would be united in it. And as Jesus later was praying and speaking to the disciples in John chapter 17, the Gospel of John chapter 17, when he gets to verses 20 and 21, he points out that there's going to be a possibility, an opportunity, that the world may believe through your word. And his point is that when you are united, speaking the same thing, of the same mind, teaching in unison and in unity the same teachings and doctrines and practices. That it is powerful enough to cause the world to believe. And I tell you, that reminded me so much back in Genesis 11, verse 6. How God pointed out that because of their unity, nothing would be impossible for them. When we are united, He says, nothing would be impossible for us. The world would believe if we are united in the Word of God. And in Acts chapter 2, when Peter and the other apostles were preaching to the Jews on that day of Pentecost, and 3,000 souls obeyed the gospel. In verses 42 through 46, it says, they continued steadfast in the apostles' doctrine and the fellowship, the breaking of bread and the prayers. And he goes on to point out that they had all things in common. They were united in the apostles' doctrine, the fellowship, the breaking of bread and the prayers. They had obeyed the same gospel, the same message that they had heard. They put into practice the very same way. The same way we are to do even today. You think about how was that possible? How was that done? And do we have other places that help illustrate or bring to our mind exactly how it is we are united? Well, that brings us to our scripture reading this morning of Ephesians chapter 4. And we're going to focus on verses 4 through 6. Not to miss verse 3, which says to be united together, but as he points out in the bond of peace, unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, be united together, speaking the same thing that the Holy Spirit has delivered unto, and to be at peace with one another. And he goes on in verses 4 through 6 to point out what we often call as the seven ones. The one body in which we are all united by one Spirit who has brought us in together to give us the one hope of eternal life in the glories of heaven. We have one Lord, which is Jesus Christ, who is, as He said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things I do? Luke 6:46. In understanding, if He's going to be our Lord, He's going to be the lawmaker. He's going to be the decision maker. He's going to be the life taker to the eternal glories of heaven. Through the one faith, one system of belief that has been delivered by the Holy Spirit to the inspired writers who have written these things down, and through one baptism which has brought us all into that one body of Christ Jesus, having one God and Father of all, who is above all and in all and through all. The problem is the devil is working to do his absolute best to destroy these fundamental points. Let's think about it this way, and it's an illustration we've used before, and I know have been used around the world in times past, but I think it illustrates the point better than most possibly can. And that is the fact that God has placed one rock in this world. Jesus in Matthew chapter 16, in verse 18, after Peter made that great confession, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus said, "Well, have you answered for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." And he goes on to say, "And I tell you," in verse 18 of Matthew 16, "that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it." I will build my church, singular, but it's upon a rock. The rock of Christ Jesus Himself, which God placed in this world, and now that chief cornerstone of which the church is built, He has given us the pattern. He has given us the Word that reveals to us all that we need to know pertaining to life and godliness about that church, about that rock. And you would think, well, if that's the case, then how could the devil possibly compete against that? Well, it's quite simple. He has placed several other rocks in this world. The problem is they're not exactly the same. We call them denominations. They're slightly different, although there are or may be some similarities. But they have changed the fundamental points, and perhaps the most important of all of them, and that is, first and foremost, the idea that there would be one faith. They said, no, there's many faiths. And they'll even ask the question, what faith are you? They've changed the meaning and the purpose of immersion in baptism. Immersion in water for the forgiveness of sins. They said, no, that's not for the forgiveness of sins. It's not to have your sins forgiven. It's not to be have entrance into the body of Christ. That's not what it's for, according to them. They'll say it's because you've already been saved, or perhaps it is for infants, and it's sprinkling, or it's pouring, and it's not immersion at all. And so they say, rather than one baptism that unites us together, there's different baptisms that they practice and claim we can be united in. And so what has happened with all of these little rocks that have been placed into the world by the devil is they have shaped themselves and formed themselves to look extremely close to the real thing in various ways, having some teachings that are in fact true, whether it's Catholicism, Orthodoxy, Lutheran, Presbyterian, Methodist, Baptist, or any other mainstream denomination, or perhaps even some non-denominational religious groups that are out there, they all claim to be on a narrow road. Maybe different ones, but still the narrow path. And in rather than leading people to Christ and to the body of Christ, they do all they can to convince people that they are saved and they are fine, and yet what they teach keeps them from being entered into the body of Christ, because you cannot be taught wrong and baptized right. Oh, they bring people close. They may teach people about Jesus and about His sacrifice, His death, burial, and resurrection. They may teach about a Messiah and even claim that they believe it was Jesus and that He came in the flesh. But you know, there were several, even in the first century, who were teaching that. After the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, remember in Ephesians chapter 19, when Paul came to Ephesus, there were certain disciples there, and he asked them, wait a minute, into what were you baptized? They said, into John's baptism. He said, well, there's a problem here. Because the Messiah has come. He has died, been buried, and raised from the dead, ascended, and seated at the right hand of God. Paul preached Christ to them, and they were then baptized into the name of the Lord Christ Jesus. And understanding this and the differences is why we are so adamant against denominationalism. Just as in our society, our world today, a man may claim to be a woman, he is not a woman. Denominations claim to be Christians, and yet they keep people from becoming Christians through their teachings. You know, the world thought that the church was just another sect of Judaism. They even accused Paul of that in Acts chapter 28. He's a part of that sect of Judaism, the Christians that follow Christ. But they looked at that as just another group of the Jews. And yet here was Paul writing to the Romans in Romans 10 by inspiration of King Jesus saying, I wish the Jews would be saved. But they're not, because they've rejected what Christ taught, His message, and Christ as a whole. In other words, Paul was making a judgment based upon their practice and their teaching. He was making a judgment to understand that, listen, based upon what you're doing, what you're practicing, what the Jews are teaching and are involved in, what they've accepted and not accepted, I can come to the judgment they are not saved. They are not Christian. I wish they were. But in order to do so, they're going to have to come to an understanding and submit themselves in obedience to the gospel of Christ. What he was doing was making a righteous judgment, which even Jesus said we're going to have to do in John 7, verse 24. Do not judge righteous judgment, but do not judge by appearance, but judge righteous judgment. Which is why when we read what John wrote in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1, he says, Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are from God. In other words, you're going to have to make a judgment when a teaching is taking place. Now, many would say, well, that seems like you're being awful judgmental. No, we're just simply doing what Christ told us to do. We're comparing, judging the what is being practiced and what is being taught, and comparing it with the Word of God, and having an understanding that when you're not teaching the gospel of Christ as it has been delivered, Paul said, let them be accursed, Galatians 1, 6 through 9. And try to teach them the truth of God's Word. You know, in Acts chapter 10, when Cornelius in verses 1 through 3 was a prayerful man, he had a good report not only among the Jews, but even with God Himself, as his prayers went up to God as a memorial. He was, by all accounts, what we would refer to in our modern vernacular, a good man. And yet Peter said in Acts 11, in verse 14, there was a message by which he would be saved. And that was the message that Peter took to him. That's the message that he took to him. And in Acts chapter 17, when Paul was on Mars Hill, he looked around and said, I see you're a religious people. Let me tell you about this God, this unknown God. He had to make a determination, a judgment, based upon their practice, based upon what they were doing and what was around them, and understand they needed the gospel of Christ. And when he got to Ephesus in Acts chapter 19 and verse 3, when it says, by inspiration of God, when Luke wrote, he found disciples, and yet they were not in Christ. And he had to make that judgment based upon what they had been taught, what they had been practicing and believed, and then he taught them the truth, and upon hearing the truth, they were then baptized in the name of the Lord Christ Jesus. Amen. You see, we all are in need of the true gospel of Christ. Not a man-made denominational version of it, but the gospel of Christ. The one that the Holy Spirit delivered through the inspired writers and have written down. Not a perversion of it. As Jesus Himself said in the Great Commission of Mark chapter 16, verse 16, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Paul in Ephesians 2 and verse 8 said that we are saved through by grace you have been saved through faith. He didn't say by faith alone. No, that is a man-made teaching that they've added to Ephesians 2. Yes, we are saved by faith, but he goes on in Ephesians 4 to point out that we are united through one baptism into one body by that one faith. Yes, we confess with our mouth. Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. Confession is made unto salvation. But it isn't until we are immersed in water into the death of Christ, Romans 6, 3 through 5. Colossians 2, which we've already looked at, buried with Him in baptism, whereby by faith we are raised up with Him through the power of God who raised Christ from the dead. And we think, why do we question whether or not someone is a child of God, whether or not someone is a Christian or not? It's because eternity is at stake. Because eternity has everything to do with it. And when we go to Galatians chapter 3, in verses 26 through 29, and we see what Paul writes, saying that we are all children of God through the faith. Now, I don't know of a translation that uses the word the faith, but if you look in the Greek manuscripts, the word the definite article the, is in the manuscripts of Galatians chapter 3 and verse 26. We are all children of God through the faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek, male or female, slave or free. For if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's. And you are all one, united together, brought together. But it isn't without our choice to submit ourselves to God's will. To say, yes, I believe in what Christ has done, and I believe, as the Scriptures teach, we must believe. We must have faith. We must be willing to repent and turn from our past sins and put the old person to death. And being put to death, we bury him in a watery grave of baptism, where we are added to the body of Christ. The blood of Christ washes away those past sins, and we rise from that watery grave to walk then a new creature in newness of life. And that is our plea and our call for every one of this world, and especially for those who are here this morning, if you haven't obeyed the gospel the way God has set forth for us to do. Not having been sprinkled or poured over as an infant or as a child, not having believed that you were saved and then, as an outward sign of an inward grace, being baptized for some other reason than what the Scriptures give, but simply putting all that aside, leaving man-made religious ideas and thoughts and preconceived notions, and simply putting into practice the Word of God. Nothing more, but certainly nothing less. If you're here this morning and you know what you need to do, we want to help you with that. We want to help you to make your life right with the Lord Christ Jesus. We want to make sure that you know and understand not only what He has taught, but we want to make sure you have that same hope as all Christians have had since the first century until He comes back to destroy this world and deliver the kingdom to the Father in heaven, that hope of eternal life in the glories of heaven. It can be yours, and He's calling you to it. And if you're willing to submit yourself to it, or as a child of God, you've sinned, you've fallen short, and you realize that the mistakes that you've made and you want to turn from them, you want to repent, and you want to request prayers, we'll be happy to pray with you for sure. But now is an opportunity to get that done. If we can help, please don't delay. Come to the front as together we stand and sing.